invite you to find your community at our upcoming Ladies Night Out. Join us as we gather to seek God while we have fun together. Our heart is that this is a space for you to connect with other women on the same mission to pursue Jesus to the fullest. Registration is now open. We can't wait to see you at Ladies Night Out.
Amen. Any ladies in the house? Come on. We toss me that? I got a special lady in the house, and it is my wife you just heard from, and we are having a baby boy. So I'm so pumped. I was like, yeah, I don't really care if it's a girl or a boy. And as soon as I saw those blue balloons, I was like, Jesus. I felt like, I don't know, I just feel like I accomplished something. It was like no different than 5 minutes before, but I was like, it just hit a little different. I don't know, you know? Well, hey, my name is Simon, and I just want to just, again, welcome you guys. It's such a privilege to have you all worshiping with us. If there's anybody looking for a seat in the back, it's a great problem, but it just means we got to get a little closer to our neighbors. We do have an 8:30 and an 11:30 a.m. service, so if you feel a little tight in here, I encourage you to hit those two services, or you just get real close to the people you're with. But again, that is a great problem to have. God is adding to the campus, and really it's because of our amazing teams, our worship teams, guys in production, our kids' church. We really just got to give credit where credit's due. So if you are serving on a Daystar Dream Team, I applaud you. You guys put your hands together for amazing ministries and ministry leaders. If you want to get a part of a ministry team right after this service, it's something we call Next Steps. It's right at the end of our runway here, our lobby space. Just head down there until you hit furniture, and we will tell you about how to get involved and how to serve on a team and be a part of community transformation that we're experiencing here in Daystar. I love to preach. It's something I like to do a lot, but I also love to hear Pastor Jerry preach. So he gave me the opportunity to speak to you guys this morning, mainly because he's in Africa. So that does kind of worked out great, you know? Could you guys put your hands together? I know he's not here. I know he's in a different country, but I love our lead pastor, Pastor Jerry and Leslie. They're not just great leaders, but they're great spiritual parents to a lot of folks, and we are blessed to get to call ourselves part of that crew. So today we are talking about revival. We're continuing this kind of just discussion. We feel like God's speaking to us all about revival, about what God's doing. And not only here, I mean, we're seeing testimonies of sparks and hearing rumors of God doing stuff all over the nation. And so we know that what we're experiencing is not just a North Alabama thing, a Daystar thing, but God is doing something today, and how awesome to be a part of it. But there's one thing that has always drawn criticism and critique and questions, and there's been more just like splits and ruffle feathers when it comes to revival and it comes to a church that's really fulfilling the Great Commission, and it's this talk about the Holy Spirit. Sadly to say, there is nothing more divisive in the Church of Jesus Christ than our orthodox about the Holy Spirit and our theology about the Holy Spirit. What we believe about the Holy Spirit and how we expect the Holy Spirit to move and how we, how we handle all this. And it shouldn't be. This is the most incredible part of being a Christian, is that God is alive and the Holy Spirit is bringing life to dead things. But I think it's sad that I think most churches are known more for what they're against than what they're for. You know, all it really takes is somebody with a gripe about how the Holy Spirit's moving in this church and a coffee pot, and then you got a whole brand new church. You know what I mean? What is your church about? Well, we're against this, you know? What is your ministry about? Well, you know, we started because we're against this, you know? I want to be a part of a church that's not known for what they're against, but what they're excited about, what they're for. And I believe that's what we're hearing the Lord say and do and speak to the church right now. I actually got a message, not at this church, it was at a different season of life, but somebody said, hey, we really want to come to your church, but we got some questions to ask you, brother. And I was like, all right, here we go. I'm thinking about, dusting off all my Bible, my Bible classes I learned, and I went to online Bible school, so some people say it's not as good, but whatever, right? I was like, all right, getting ready. And they're like, what do you think about the Trinity, right? And we talked about the Trinity. What do you think about, the filling of the Holy Spirit? And they're like, that's all good, but I will not come to your church if you believe in spanking children, we're not doing it, you know? And I was like, really? You know, they wanted us to have something on our website about we do not believe in spanking children. I was like, you might have the wrong church, man. You know, if like that's, like, I'm sure there's a church out there somewhere. You go on their website, first church of this, nonspankingchildren.com, and they're like, we don't spank children here. Come on, you know? And that's sad to say, but you know what? The Holy Spirit wants us to unite and find unity, not on the one or two things that we have different about other, you know, other folks or even each other, but man, there's so much that we can agree about and get excited about and really come into unity to see God do about the Holy Spirit. So today, I want to talk about from the heart, the head to the heart. I had to remember which one's which, right? That's what the role of the Holy Spirit does in revival, in these moves of God historically, and how the Lord does, you know, teaches us as we follow Jesus. He takes things from the head to the heart. All right, everybody, because I was a youth pastor for like 100 years, everyone do this. From the head, you got to touch your head, to the heart. That's what the Holy Spirit does. And that might not seem like a long distance, but if you were like a lot of us that were stubborn, and we might have had a head full of Jesus, but a heart full of, you know, the world, that is a long way for truth to go from here to here. But that's what only the Holy Spirit can do. Let's take a look at a scripture that we're talking about today as we fall in love with the Holy Spirit. It's this, 2 Corinthians 3:17. I would encourage you guys to take notes. All the scriptures that I'm bringing to you today are what I call like battle verses. There are these things where I noticed in my life that I didn't even realize I had these verses memorized until the Holy Spirit kind of brought them out in certain situations. Like I'd be talking to somebody about the Lord, or I'd be sharing my faith with somebody, or I'd be asked a question. And these are the scriptures that kind of leapt out. And so I think they are important for all of us to know and kind of have in our back pocket. So this is 2 Corinthians 3:17, and it reads this. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what?
Freedom.
Man, we believe that. And there's so many things that we can pick apart and disagree about, but I think, man, let's all get behind that. That where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. What does the Holy Spirit want to bring to people's life? Freedom. Good things. And I love this, that as we talk about the Holy Spirit, here's something that's very important. It's that now where the Lord is the Spirit. So as we talk about the Holy Spirit, I want to kind of ease some tension and ease some you know, maybe some bad experiences you had, is that when we talk about the Holy Spirit, we are a firm believer in the Trinity, and that ultimately the Holy Spirit is just as an important member of the Trinity, the triune being of God, as God the Father and God the Son. So ultimately, when the scriptures tell us about the Holy Spirit, it's not telling us about a peripheral kind of like, you know, like the something extracurricular when it comes to our faith, is that the Holy Spirit is God. And that is a mystery that will be unraveled for the rest of time. When we get to heaven, we can ask God how all that works. But it's important for us to know that the Holy Spirit is the Lord. And here's the thing. Right off the bat, let me address this one thing right off the bat. What keeps most people away from diving in and learning more about the Holy Spirit? And it is the one thing. That a lot of people think that the Holy Spirit is just straight up weird, right? When we think about, you know, and like if you've never come from a background where you are used to this or you know, and it's funny how you can even get used to weird stuff. I've been in a bunch of weird churches. After a while, you're like, yeah, it's whatever. They just do that, you know. The color guard is, yeah, there's flags. I don't get it. There's a conch shell and a tuba. Like, you know, like, but you don't really realize that to people that don't know about the Holy Spirit, it is a little strange, right? But you know what I found out is it's not really that the Holy Spirit's weird. It's just that people are weird, right? And you just give people an opportunity to be weird and get away from it. And there's just a select group of the human population. It's like, I'm showing up. You know what I'm saying? Like, I get to dance and like, you know, like they're just going to do that anyway. You know, because I think about, you guys know a little bit of my testimony. I was a heavy drinker, an alcoholic drinker for a long time. And man, alcohol makes people weird too. But we don't say alcohol's weird. We just say that person's weird and should be left off of alcohol, right? You got the people that are, you know, they're stoic and they're rock hard, and you put a couple drinks in the Super Bowl party and they're yelling at the screen and flipping tables and fighting with their relatives. You're like, what was that? That was weird. Or the person that's always happy, and as soon as you put a couple drinks in them, they start crying. They love you. I love you. And you're like, I love you too. No, I love you. You're like, I love you too. You know, like That's kind of weird, but we don't say alcohol is weird. But we kind of do that with the Holy Spirit. We paint in a really broad stroke. But let me tell you what, the Holy Spirit is God. And God wants nothing but good for you and good for me. And let me tell you what, we can't have revival without the presence of the Holy Spirit. There is no revival. There is no move of God. There is no moving forward of the kingdom of God unless we step into sometimes things we haven't all the way understood yet. I want you to know that this is a safe place, and you have my word that nothing weird and dangerous is going to happen from this pulpit and from this platform, but you do need to know that I am desperate to see the Holy Spirit move in our church, that I'm desperate to see the Holy Spirit move in our community, and North Alabama would have the same life-giving encounter that some of us have had to have with the Holy Spirit. So let's get into it. The Holy Spirit makes things real, all right? Say, he makes it real. The Holy Spirit takes our faith and makes it real. And there's three things that the Holy Spirit makes real in our life. I'm going to talk about these, and we are going to get out of here. And the first is that the Holy Spirit makes sin real in the life of a believer. The second thing is that the Holy Spirit makes the love of God real to us that believe. And finally, the Holy Spirit makes the power of God real, okay? So let's take the first one. As we go from this journey from the head to the heart, let's look at how the Holy Spirit makes sin real in our lives. And this is a great scripture. John 16, verse 7 and 8. And I'm going to go ahead and read them, but you can take notes and study this stuff out yourself. John 16, 7 and 8. And it reads this. This is Jesus talking to us. He says, "Nevertheless, I tell you, it is to your advantage that I go. For if I do not go away, the helper," and that is the Holy Spirit, it's another word for the Holy Spirit is the helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. So I think about this. The best way I can explain it is an example out of my own life. How does the Holy Spirit convict us of sin? How does the Holy Spirit make sin real? So I was a rock and roller through and through, man. You know what I'm saying? I was not born and raised in church, but I loved music, and I was part of bands and music my whole life. And so when I got saved out of a rock band. We were touring, and we were not very successful, but I like to think we were. But we were touring, and I was living the life. I was playing music every night, and I got radically touched and saved, and I had an encounter with the Holy Spirit. But then I kind of got released back into the same lifestyle. Like, I wound up at like a conference. I got touched by the Lord. God did such a work in me, and then I was right back in the same atmosphere that I had got saved out of, and nothing had changed out there, but like, everything had changed, if that makes sense. If someone feel me, everything was different, but nothing was different. And back when I got saved, we didn't have MP3 players and Bluetooth anything. We had like CDs, right? I know some of you guys are like, well, back in my day, I had 8 tracks, and you had a vinyl in the car. I don't know. We had CDs, right? And we didn't text and drive, but we literally navigated Encyclopedia Britannica sized books of CDs. They were like, you'd be flipping through them, and we had burnt CDs, and they had the head, CDs everywhere, right? And I felt like the best way to get to know somebody was like, what kind of music do you listen to? Like, who's your bands, Like, that's how we connected the dots with people. What are you into, with music? And I was a music lover. I still love music, but no one told me that I needed to change the music I was listening to. Like I said, I had this radical encounter with God and went right back to my life. So I remember, I was coming home from going to work, and I would come in and I would read my Bible and pray, and I was just having these wonderful just encounters with God, hours in the presence of the Lord. He was speaking to me. He was telling me how much he loved me, and I was, I had like one burnt CD with a bunch of like worship songs this one preacher guy made me, and I would just listen to that CD. I'd keep it at the house, but I'd get out my car and I'd just put in old stuff, like Love Nirvana, Foo Fighters, Weezer. Weezer was probably at that time my favorite band. I had this Weezer CD, and I'm not encouraging you to listen to Weezer, right? So I had this Weezer CD, and it was my favorite one. It was from the album Pinkerton, and I would put it in the CD player, and I was just ready for it to happen. Like, I loved it. I knew every lick, every guitar lick. I could air guitar, bass guitar, air drum, all of it, right? And I remember one day I put it in, and instead of this like nostalgic good feeling of my favorite album, it was like, it kind of hit weird. It was like nails on a chalkboard. I was like, that's strange. I love the CD. Maybe I'm just getting tired of it. And I took it out and put another CD in, and it was, and the same thing happened. And I really didn't know what was going on. But what was really going on is that, man, the Holy Spirit was beginning to do a work inside of me. He was doing this, and we use this church word. It's called sanctification. It's when we're being regenerated from the inside out. But I didn't know what was happening. It was just accidentally happening. And listen, I've already repented and made amends to the county this happened in. But I would roll down my little window, driving in those Mississippi streets, and that CD, the one I loved for my whole life, it became such this weird thing that wasn't producing life. I just took it out and I was like, "See ya," and I would just pluck it out the window like a frisbee. You know, get behind me, Satan. You know, I was like throwing, and again, I've made amends, you know, and then I'd put another CD in. All of a sudden, my CD collection started getting really thin, till all I had was the Bible on CD, and James Earl Jones was reading Genesis, and I'd put it in, I'd be like, yes, this is awesome, you know, talking about the letter of the law, why? Because it was producing life in me. I didn't know what was going on, and I especially didn't have a button-down preacher in my face telling me, if you don't get rid of that music, you're going to hell, right? There was nothing. It was just the Holy Spirit was convicting me of sin. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. When we let the Lord in, he begins to renew us from the inside out. And just like those CDs that I was chucking out the window, man, bad relationships were getting chucked out. Remember my cigarette habit was getting chucked out. You know, I was cussing like a sailor. And man, I could paint these murals with like two or three, four-letter words. You know, my language got chucked out of the window. I was beginning to change radically, and nobody was in my face pointing a finger at me telling me I needed to do that or needed to do this. It was coming from the inside out. That's what the Holy Spirit does, begins to renew us. But the church, we have a bad habit. The church has a bad habit of shooting on the world. Shooting, S-H-O-U-L-D-I-N-G. We should on the world, on a bunch of people that don't care about anything we have to say or anything we say. You should go to church. You should break up with your boyfriend. You should quit smoking. You shouldn't do this, right? We heap all these stuff on people, but without the Holy Spirit, that's nothing but dead religion. And if you're like me and you don't want no one to tell you what to do, it actually turns you away from God. When we start shooting on people, it makes people run, and we actually do it to ourselves. Man, I should be a better person. I shouldn't argue with my wife. I shouldn't smoke. I shouldn't drink or whatever. Man, what we need is the Holy Spirit to convict us of sin and the power of God to transform us. That's what the Holy Spirit does. That's what revival does. And most people that walk up in here, they know they should or shouldn't be doing stuff. They don't need us to tell them, right? They need us to offer them something to help them. Can I get an amen? Come on, somebody. So let me read this, that God wants more for you than he wants from you. The Lord is my shepherd. It's not on the screen. This is how God comes into our life. He says, we shall not want. He makes us to lie down in green pastures, and he leads us in paths of righteousness. For his name's sake, what does that mean? When we say yes to Jesus, he is naturally going to lead us into a path of righteousness. Not because we have to, not because he's angry at us, not because we're going to go to hell if we don't get it right. It's because we just love Jesus, and the Holy Spirit's just telling us to follow him, and we like accidentally wind up walking out a life that we can never do for ourselves. If you've wound up in here and you're tired of trying to fix yourself and fix this part of your marriage and fix that and fix this, fall in love with the Holy Spirit and watch what he'll do in your life, because he'll do for you what you could never do for yourself. I got a scripture for you. It's Ezekiel 36, 26. I was going to skip it, but I think this is so good. This is a scripture that I think, again, just put it in your back pocket, meditate on this, and it's this idea that God gives us a desire for godliness and righteousness. This is the prophet Ezekiel. He says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. Ezekiel was talking, he was prophesying about a time when Israel and the world would not be under the Old Testament law, but there would be a new covenant where we're actually alive with Jesus, just like Lacey was talking about, that it's us and the Lord. We have this personal relationship. I know it's kind of covered up. I'm sorry, guys. Ezekiel 36, 26. This idea that God actually takes out this stony heart, that doesn't want anything to do with God, that wants our own way and is stubborn. He actually takes that out and gives us a heart of flesh. And typically what happens, he gives us a heart transplant before anything in our life changes. So you're like tore up from the floor up, the same person you used to be with this heart that wants nothing but Jesus, right? And you're like, this is crazy. I want the Lord, but my life is so wild. And I'm just telling you, just love God, invite the Holy Spirit in, and your life will change. The second thing the Holy Spirit makes real is the love of God. And this is what I really felt like very impressed that God wanted to speak to us today and not forget, is that the Holy Spirit makes the love of God real in our lives. What does that mean? It means that God gives us a brand new identity. Christian talk, we might say, you know, it's your identity in Christ or something like that. But really, it's when God's love for us becomes the new foundation on what we build our life on. Let's read this. It's Romans 8, 15 and 16. He said, for you did not, and this is the Apostle Paul writing to the Church of Rome. He said this, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. And that Abba, Father, that means it was literally he didn't translate it for us. Abba, Father means just like dad, like a loving father, daddy, God, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And I love that, bears witness. That literally translates to like he convinces our spirit that we are children of God. So sometimes this isn't an overnight thing, but Paul says the Holy Spirit will wrestle your spirit down to the ground, pin it down, and convince it that you are now a child of God. So what does that mean? Is that the love that God has for you, the love that God has for me as a father becomes our new identity. As opposed to what? As opposed to the way that we look at ourselves, right? It's so easy to view our identity by our reputation, by the kind of clothes we wear, the image we want to put out, you know, or, you know, maybe our identity is all the stuff that we screwed up in our life, you know, like, man, I'm known, my identity is I'm known as a failure, as a relapser, as a, you know, whatever. Or the flip side of that is the self-righteous thing. Your identity becomes, man, I'm so wealthy, I'm so successful, man, don't you see the kind of car I drive, man, I go to Smith Lake on the weekends. Like, our identity can easily get trapped up in all this stuff when God says, when you become a child of God, the identity that everything is built on your life becomes one thing, and it is God's love for you. That might not seem like a big deal. That is the biggest deal. That is the biggest deal, because what does it mean to be a child of God, really? When that becomes our identity, what does that really mean? It means that when we look at our life, we know to the core of who we are that we are loved unconditionally. Whether I'm on a winning streak or a losing streak, it doesn't really matter because God loves me the same. Whether I'm crushing it in my life, whether I'm just feeling like I'm struggling right now, it doesn't matter because God loves me for who I am, not for what I can accomplish, not for what I do, not for my good works, not for my bad works, but for who I am in God. When God becomes our Father and this becomes our new identity, it means that nothing can separate us from the love of God. That on my worst day, when I feel ashamed of myself, I'm not one step further away from God than when I feel like I'm killing it in my life. That's what it means to have an identity in God. And it means that I'm being cheered on by a father. You know, your heavenly father wants you to win. He doesn't want you to lose. Everything in our life, when we really believe that God is our father, man, it means he's setting us up one step at a time, one level at a time, in order for us to win. And when we know that we know that God's our father and he loves us, it means even the hard things in my life right now, they're not to destroy me, but they're to make me better. If you're facing a hard situation and you know that God's your heavenly father, it means that he's putting you in the gym, right? He wants you to get strong. He wants you to be successful and be able to handle more. So that means whatever I'm looking at isn't here to destroy me, discourage me, to take me out. It means he wants to take me up. Does that make sense? That only happens, though, when the Holy Spirit takes this from here to here, because it doesn't really do much good here. And this isn't like a positive affirmation thing. You look in the mirror and you go, you know, I'm a child of God, I'm a child of God. You know, like, it's not like that. Like, the only way that this begins to change our life is when the Holy Spirit makes this real. He takes it from information, he turns it into revelation. Amen. The last thing the Holy Spirit makes real in our life is the power of God. The Holy Spirit makes the power of God real. And what does that mean? The power of God. And how is that could be real? So Paul, again, the Apostle Paul, he was preaching to another church, the Corinthian church, and he was doing his best to explain to them that, listen, the gospel, what we're up here talking about, what we're offering, you know, Morgan County and North Alabama, this isn't just like a feel-good message, right? This isn't like a hype you up, make you feel good, you know, change your mindset, change your life, kind of, you know, like that kind of thing. Like, he's like, this isn't even about words. The gospel, what the Holy Spirit wants to do in your life, is all about power coming into your life to change your situation and to change you. This is how he describes this. He says, I came to you in weakness with great fear and trembling. This is the Apostle Paul talking to the Corinthians. He said, my message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words. And the thing about Paul is that he was one of the best orators of his day. He was classically trained. He was a professional communicator. But when Paul presented the gospel to a new group of people, he's like, I'm not trying to get slick with it. I'm not trying to make this like a smooth multi-level marketing thing. Like, I just literally am going to drop the truth to you because I don't want this to be about words, but about power. Because he says this, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith may not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. And this is, man, this is what happens when the Holy Spirit really begins to do a work in your life. And these three things I shared with you, these aren't just like personal things. This is historically what happens when a group of people, they walk into a season that we don't have a better word for it, but we call it revival. The first great awakening in America, the second great awakening in America. There was this thing called the Welsh Revival, the Azusa Street Revival. God has been doing things like in seasons and times of people's lives. And these three things are always an earmark of what God's doing, a new thing in the earth. And right now, I mean, I don't know if you're on social media or the news, but there's these rumors that, hey, God's doing a new thing. And I know from the stories we're hearing and the things that we're hearing from this church and our community, God's doing a new thing here in North Alabama. But these three things will always happen, is that God will make sin real to people. People that were far from God or people that were even in church and the things they were involved with, they just didn't, not that big a deal. But man, the Holy Spirit will make sin real. And God will always, always reveal sin to us, not to condemn us, but because he wants to lead us into something better. And we draw him. And the second thing the Holy Spirit always does is makes the love of God real to us. But the third thing, and I think one of the most important earmarks of when God is moving, and we call it revival, is that the power of God becomes very real and people get hungry to see God move. For the longest time in my life, I felt like I was praying illegal prayers, right? It wasn't years until someone said, like, encourage me in what I'm about to encourage you. So I hope you get to skip some of this weird season I was in for a long time. Is that man, God had moved in my life. Gun to my head, you could not tell me God wasn't real. I knew God was real. I wasn't perfect, am not perfect, will never be perfect, but I was serving a perfect Jesus. Like, and he was real to me. And all of a sudden my life began to change and I started, man, just selling out. Like, there was nothing that was more important to me than knowing Jesus. And then all of a sudden this desire started welling up inside of me and I didn't know what to do with it. And it was simply this, that I just wanted the same power that had changed my life and was moving in my life. I started getting hungry for that to touch other people's lives, right? I started saying, like, God, I'm so grateful for what you're doing. Like, I love you, and I love to worship, and I love to come into your presence, and I love coming to church for me. But I started realizing, I was like, man, I feel like there's more. I feel like there's this other thing that God wanted to do. And it was simply this, that God was inviting me to answer the call that he would use my life. and I felt so inadequate. I said, God, I don't even know another Christian in my family. I'm not from like, a pastor's home, right? You know, my family is so jacked up. Lord, you probably couldn't use me or whatever. And I remember I couldn't even hide it anymore. So I'd answer these altar calls, or I'd have these moments in God's presence, and I'd be like, God, use me, change me. I'm such a sinner. But in the back of my mind, I was like, but God, can you use me to like touch other people? I started getting hungry. God, could you use my life? Could I say yes to you in a way that like, man, that my whole direction of my life changed? And I just kind of felt it was illegal. Like, I didn't know when you got to that point, right? I didn't know when you were like Christian enough where I could believe that God was going to use me to do miracles, signs, and wonders, and to call other people out of darkness and into light. I kind of felt like, man, one day maybe Daystar is going to send me a postcard and say, like, you passed the test. Like, you are now spiritual enough for God to use you, you know? But no one ever did. I kind of would come to services, and I'd be like, oh, I want to get used by God, you know? And I was just waiting for the pastor to, like, say, you are ready, you know? You know what I mean? Like, but that never happened. But I started getting restless, and I started looking at my life and saying, God, I want you to use me. And I know I'm imperfect, and I know I got a long way to go, but God, if you're looking for somebody to use, I'll do it. I might not be your first choice, I might not be your second choice, but I am willing, and I want you to use my life. And I'm telling you, that is the Holy Spirit moving in the life of a surrendered servant. God has a way of not using perfect people, because perfect people tend to get all the credit. Sometimes God uses broken people, people that are still in process with flaws, with failures, because when God uses somebody's life, that doesn't make sense. And even people who the world would call foolish, God has a way of getting all the glory out of those situations. Now, I feel like God wants to do that here. I feel like if we're not careful, we'll sit back and we'll be so grateful for what God's doing in us and the power we're seeing him move. But I want to stir and intentionally awaken a hunger in you to say, what if there's more? What if God wants to use me? What if I'm not at my job just to pull a check? Or what if the future that God has for me isn't 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when my life is perfect, then God can finally use me? What if right here, right now, if you said yes to the Holy Spirit using your life, you could go back to work tomorrow, not because that's your vocation, but God's called you there to make a difference for such a time as this. You know, and the Holy Spirit is the only one that can do this. For the longest time, I was worried that I was going to wind up on some mission field in like Indonesia or something, you know? Because I was like, Lord, I don't even know what the question is. But God, whatever you want from me, the answer is yes. Before you even get it out your mouth, the answer is yes. I remember saying to the Lord, there's no price that I won't pay. There's nothing I won't walk away from, God, to have your best for my life. Lord, if there's something that is on your heart and you want to have accomplished in the earth, God, I might not even be the top 10, but Lord, I want you to use me. And I was scared to death that he would say, well, there's two people in the woods, you know, in Micronesia, and I need them to hear the gospel. And that was going to be my calling, right? But when you get to a place where the love of God is the foundation of your life, it doesn't matter if you preach to 1 million people or you preach to 2 people in the woods, it's all the same unto him, right? It doesn't matter if I'm a school teacher or I'm an apostle to the nations, it's all for him. If I'm a stay-at-home mom or I'm a businesswoman just killing it, making all the money, it's all for him. And when you don't need anything out there to make you okay in here, God can do anything with you. But when we live needing the approval of people, come on, that's for the Lord. We get stuck in the box. God knows I can use him only up to here, because to go any further, people are going to say things about him, or people aren't going to be able to, you know, he's not going to get the affirmation and the validation he needs. He's not going to make the money he thinks he needs to be happy. So we create the boxes that we get stuck in. God doesn't want us in any boxes. God wants to be able to do exceedingly and abundantly more than we could think or even ask him, but we box ourselves in because our foundation isn't that God just loves me and is going to do whatever he wants to with my life. But guys, I want to challenge us. We have such an opportunity right now. And I'm not talking about church growth and Daystar. I'm talking about the kingdom of God. Hell getting pushed back and people getting saved and people getting loved right now. It's, yes, we really do. And he's not looking for perfect people. He's looking for people to say, God, I just want you to use me. And I want you to know that is a legal prayer. You are allowed to pray that. I'm going to pray that for you today. And if you don't want that, just cover your ears and run, because I'm volunteering all of you guys into the Lord's army and what he wants to do right now. And you might say, well, man, it's getting stuffy in here and I might lose my seat. Or you know what? There's people that come in here and they smell like beer and cigarettes. Good. Send them to my row. I want to sit with people that smell like beer and cigarettes, because that means that we're reaching the people that God wants us to reach out of this church. I'll send the guys that have the good smell and perfect perfume to your section. Send me the ones that smell like they threw up on themselves last night, but for whatever reason, they wound up in our church, and God's going to rock their world, man. That's who I'm hungry to reach. Come on, man. Guys, the Lord is so good. I just, man, it's such an honor to be in leadership here and to get to say yes to Jesus. But I just, I want you guys to know, like, my heart is to see God just rescue so many more people that were just like me, that were without a hope, and without the Lord doing something in my life, I would be absolutely nothing. And the fact that I could convince the girl to marry me, and I'm having kids, and I'm employable, and like God's even using my life, that is a miracle. You guys didn't know who I was 20 years ago, 15 years ago. And I want a nice church, and don't get me wrong, you guys hear my heart, but my heart is for those that don't know him yet, you know? I believe it. He will leave the 99 and go for the one. Can I pray for you guys? Would you bow your heads with me? Lord, I thank you for your spirit, Lord. I thank you for this opportunity to step into something brand new in our church. God, and I just pray that you would help us, Lord. Seize the day. Not miss the day of your visitation, Lord. God, I pray that like we're the wise virgins, Lord, that have our lamps lit, but we've got oil, God, that we're anointed, that we've invited the Holy Spirit into what we're doing, because we don't want to miss you, Jesus. We don't want to miss you, Jesus. Father, I just pray for those that don't know you yet, or maybe they know you in their head, but you want to get in their heart. God, you want to close the gap today between the head and the heart in somebody's life. And guys, if you're out there and you just feel the Lord tugging on you, this isn't a trick, this isn't an emotional thing, it is the Spirit of God knocking on the door of your heart saying, let me in, let me love you, let me use you. If you're in this place today and you want to make a decision to give your life to Jesus, your sin, not just the bad stuff, but the good stuff. Not just the, hey, clean me up and then let me go out of here and do my own thing. If you feel the Lord saying, like, all of me belongs at the feet of the cross. Like, the good, the bad, my past, but also my future. Also the things I could be, I want to give those to the Lord. If you feel this call to give God just everything this morning, would you raise your hand? I want to pray with you. If you're in this place and you're just saying, you know what, Jesus, I want to know you. I want to walk with you. I want you to use me. Come on, I see someone. Is there anyone else? This is an awesome moment. Hey, I see you in the back. I see you in the back. I see you, brother. I see you. Amen. 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 Let's pray. Would you allow me to lead you in a prayer? Repeat after me. Say, dear Jesus, I love you today. Thanks for speaking to me. Thank you for calling me to yourself. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me in your blood. And use my life. I give you my past. I give you my present. I give you my future. Have all of me, God. Use me. In the name of Jesus. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Can you guys put your hands together? Woo! Awesome. Awesome. It's awesome. If you said yes and you made a decision today, help me know about it. On those connect cards, fill it out. There's a place on the bottom, and I'm getting all teared up. There's a place on the bottom that you could say that you've dedicated your life or rededicated your life to Jesus, let me know so we can pray for you, so we can get some folks around you and we can help you walk this out. Like I mentioned, next steps is all the way at the end of this. If you just feel like, you know what, I'm on the sideline too long, I'm ready to get involved, I want something to do around here at church, you know, I want to be a part of this, get in there, and we've got plenty of opportunities for you guys to serve and make a difference. Amen? Would you grab those offering buckets? They're on the right-hand side. If you're sitting on the right, your right-hand side, and would you stand up with me? We're going to get out of here. What a good day to be at church. You guys feeling good? God's good. I'm excited about the future. Thank you guys for your generosity. Your Connect cards go in here, so the cards you filled out and your prayer requests that go in here. Also, you can give online, daystarchurch.tv. And I just want to thank you for your generosity, your ability to, you're helping us to be able to fulfill God's mission in the earth by your generosity. Thank you. Go ahead and pass those buckets. I'm just kind of filling in right here. I'm just kind of just talking, just yapping it up. And let me bless you guys. We're going to get out of here. Lord, I thank you for your people. God, I thank you for your spirit. I thank you for revival. God, and we say yes. Bless every tithe and offering, God, that's coming in the house. God, I pray you would multiply it for more people to know of your great love and power. Be with us as we go and being salt and light in the world. We love you, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Everybody said amen. God bless you guys. If you need prayer, the prayer team will be up front. We'll see y'all next week. Not for